Welcome to Arizona Bill Watch, the show where you get satisfaction if you're not getting it from your state legislators. We report and comment at what happens at the state legislature and alert you on what is coming up next. And now, here are the hosts of Arizona Bill Watch, Jose and Archie.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Arizona Bill Watch, the show that gives you satisfaction if you're not getting it from your state legislators. We do it by discussing in detail important and controversial bills. I am your host, Jose Borajero, and I am here with co-host Archie Dixon. There is a lot going on at the Capitol, so stay tuned because we have a fantastic show for you today. Senate Bill SCR 1020, short title, English Language Education Requirements. Folks, this bill is one of the bills that could conceivably be one of the worst bills to go through the legislature this session. But you wouldn't know it by the way people have been voting because it has been very popular. This bill is a Senate bill, which is a companion bill to House Bill SCR 2005. They are exactly the same bill. One is running in the House, one is running in the Senate. Now, we have discussed this issue at length when the vote came up for HCR 2005, that is the House version of it. So we're not gonna get into that. All you need to do in order to find out that information is to go to my YouTube channel, and you can access that very easily. Go to YouTube and then search for my name down here, Jose Borajero, and then when you get to my channel, all you have to do is enter the bill number, and then you can watch the video on it. So we're not going to be covering most of what we covered before because it's the same way, do it twice. But some things have happened since then, and I want to bring your attention to a couple of them. Number one is that since we did that video, there has been a vote in the House, the full House of Representatives. And that bill, when I said it was very popular, it passed the House 59-1. Actually, it was 51-1, and there was one abstention, I believe. There was only one vote in the whole House of Representatives that voted against this bill. Now, that vote came from, get this, that vote came from an individual, a representative whose name I cannot pronounce, but I'll try my best. I think it's Nguyen or Nguyen. He is a Vietnamese individual. And it so happens that this Vietnamese individual and his wife were English learners. They're immigrants from Vietnam, and they learned to speak English using the full immersion system. And that is exactly what this bill is intended to replace and get rid of. It is intending to replace the provisions of Proposition 203 that the voters passed back in that demanded that English learners we have some hours of immersion in English. The Senate version, the one that we're talking about today, also cleared the Senate, but this time it cleared it, it was 24-6. So in this case, we didn't have just one senator that voted against it. We had six senators that voted against it. So we're making some progress, I suppose. Yeah. But it is a very bad bill if you want English learners to learn English. Now today, we are very fortunate because we have with us, in addition to looking at Archie and me, we are fortunate to have with us somebody who actually knows something about education. It is Diane Douglas, and she was, for 4 years, she was a superintendent of public instruction, so she probably knows about education more than 10 times Archie and mine combined, you know? So with any more to say about it, we'll let her take over, and because she has a few things to say about this bill, and what the consequences are, and how we got to this point, et cetera.
Thank you, Jose. Thank you, Archie, for having me here today. I am a little surprised by this bill, to say the least. especially surprised that it's being run by the Republicans. While I was in office, there was a big push for from different quarters to repeal English language immersion, and I absolutely would not. We had an office in the Department of Education, OLS, the English Language Acquisition Services Office, and that was to help schools and help them provide the immersion services that people need. Jose, you yourself, you're an excellent example of how English immersion works. I have
only if you like my English.
I like your English just fine, sir. I have another friend, colleague, who was actually spent some time growing up in South America, and in that case, it was Spanish immersion, and he talks about how crucial that was to his education, and we know how vital that is for these students to be successful in our country, in our system, and I worry that they're going to be relegated to second-class citizenship if we don't appropriately and properly and as quickly as possible teach them English. Now, the immersion that we started, and I wonder if our legislators are aware that this fight goes back to a lawsuit that was filed in 1992, the Flores lawsuit, over the fact that Latino children were not being taught English in Nogales, Arizona. Hmm. And that lawsuit went on for, I think it was ultimately 23 years before it was resolved, while that lawsuit was grinding its way through. Our legislature, well, our citizens passed Prop 203 for English only language in schools. And then our legislature had a big fight because it was about the funding. Were we funding enough to teach children how to speak English in our schools? That was the battle. And ultimately, the legislature resolved it, and with English language immersion. And this bill could undo all of that, that whole legal battle. And what's it, number one, what's it going to do with our children? But then is Arizona going to end up back in another lawsuit because it's not appropriately teaching children how to speak English?
I wonder what the motivation is for, now look, if you buy into the mantra that Republicans don't care about Hispanics, you know, and that they don't care about them learning English or whatever, but the Democrats do, then I could understand it. But every single Democrat,
supported it.
Yeah. So it's amazing to me that that people who should know better. I mean, if you have, look, I don't have any children in school, but if I have children in school and they were speaking Spanish at home, I would be tickled pink that they're going to spend 4 hours in English immersion so that they learn English so they don't have to wash dishes the rest of their lives.
Well, and that's what I found out with my staff in, I mentioned OLS, the Office of English Language Acquisition Services. We had people that were boots on the ground in the schools, and they said what they found were the parents coming to them and begging that their children be taught English as efficiently and as effectively as humanly possible. Now, we had the 4-hour immersion model, and then I don't remember whether it was 2017 or 2018, while I was still on the Board of Ed, the State Board of Ed reduced it to a 2-hour model. But the way they reduced it was through testing for proficiency. So you're in a 4-hour model, but as you become stronger in English, we're going to cut back on the immersion time and get you more mainstreamed, if you will. Well, then the year after that, and I think that might have been 2019, I think it was out after I was out of office, it might have been 2020, a bill is run that says we're going to cut it down to 2 hours, whether you're proficient or not.
And as I recall, that bill passed.
And that bill passed, and so now we have a 2-hour model, but now the next step is they want to take it out completely, and I...
And you know what? I still remember that last year there was a similar bill to take it out completely, and that bill eventually failed. But this year, And it failed because, well, I'm not going to get into why it failed, but it was one or two people actually managed to kill it, which is a good thing. But this year, we don't have that protection, and it's sailing right through. And for the life of me, I cannot understand why the Republicans are voting for this.
Well, and one of the things that surprised me when I was in office, when I was superintendent, I had created some advisory boards to help, you know, with decision-making and processes and whatnot. I had an Asian American board, or call it an Asian board, Asian American, Latino American advisory board, whatever. And, I would never mention any names of the people who were on it, but they were, I would call them pretty high level, pretty elite Latinos within our community and state. And I ultimately ended up disbanding the committee because all they ever wanted to talk about was bringing bilingual education back. And I said, it's not the law of the land. It's not a method that is supporting. The Office of Civil Rights from the federal government came to us while I was in office, and they actually increased the cut rate for proficiency, which ultimately ended up making English language immersion look less successful than it really is in our schools. Concern is not the right word. My thought is, if there's a failure, and I have indirectly heard from one of the legislators who's running, Representative Fillmore, who's running the bill that's on the House side, he has told people that it's because our Spanish-speaking students are not learning core academic content in this type of program. Well, with all due respect to Representative Fillmore, what I would say is you're criticizing a system that can't teach English language arts proficiency to English language speaking students. So if there's a failure of immersion, in my opinion, it is the failure of how the districts are implementing the program. It's not a failure of English immersion as a concept.
Yeah.
So speaking of implementing, I have a question for you. There are two bills pending, which is going to require that students be taught by remote learning in various percentages. How are you going to have the immersion program operative if the students are doing remote learning?
In my opinion, it's not going to be successful. It's going to be no more successful than our schools and our districts that have tried to teach our kindergartners and first graders to read remotely. It's not going to happen.
It's not going to work. No, it just won't.
Successful.
It won't.
And then we're going to end up, in my opinion, once again, probably in a lawsuit over this. And the other thing we have to take a look at is what they're pushing, it seems, in some cases, is not necessarily bilingual education, but rather dual language enrollment programs, which are a bit different. But then are our school districts, and this is a hypothetical question, are our school districts then going to use what is English language learner funding to run these dual language programs for English speaking students in addition to your English learners, your English language learners? And then I would see another lawsuit coming because we're basically misappropriating the funding that's intended to help children learn to speak English.
Well, the only thing I can say about that, and we've talked about this at length before, as I said, we have another video on it. We have been talking to legislators. We have been saying everything we can to oppose this disaster. Actually, it's only a disaster if you really want these kids to learn English properly. One thing that I know for a fact is that you cannot be proficient in a language unless you learn to think in that language. Mm-hmm. If you have to translate back and forth, you're never going to be proficient in that language, no matter who you are.
Well, and one of the other issues with the English immersion program that doesn't seem to be properly applied is it's supposed to be a short-term program. You know, get the kids in within a year, two absolute tops, and that should be the long end of it. It is an immersion program to get these kids speaking English and understanding and thinking in English as quickly as humanly possible. And that's how they will be successful in America.
And then they can join the mainstream and graduate from the school just like the rest of the kids do and apply for jobs, et cetera, et cetera. So,
if I have a minute, I'd like to point out something to Mr. Shope that maybe he needs to go back and read his bill and make a further amendment to his bill, because this bill basically repeals Title 15, Section 751, 52, 53, 54, and 55. But if you go to the bill as Mr. Shope has left it and you look at what is Section A2B, he continues to say that the State Board of Education shall adopt alternative English instruction models pursuant to Sections 15.753, which he has repealed. So, I mean, you can't, they can't be directed to go to a section that doesn't exist. So he needs to amend this even further, and maybe it'd be a good idea if he just totally withdraws it. That'd be a better thing,
that
Mr. Shope.
That would be the best idea.
That would be my suggestion to you.
Senate Bill SB 1433, short title, Students Distance Learning Plans Funding. This bill was introduced by Senator Mesnard, and it will be heard in the House Education Committee on the 23rd. And let me tell you briefly what the bill actually does. It requires that students who receive instruction through distance learning plan be funded at the same amount as students receiving in-person instruction. And it does that regardless of or even if the expenses incurred are considerably lower. In other words, same funding, less teaching. And that does not make a whole lot of sense. However, as you folks know, by now, the bills that succeeded in the Senate are being heard in the House and vice versa. This is a Senate bill. It will be heard in the House Education Committee. But it passed the Senate by a vote of 24-6. So it has wide bipartisan support. Why? I don't know.
I do.
Now, just for the record, there were six senators that voted against it. All six senators that voted against it were Republicans, and I'll tell you who they were. I'm going to out them, okay? Bartow, Livingston, Peterson, Rogers, Townsend, and Eugene Rita. Apparently, these are only the six Republicans that actually read the bill. So, anyway... we're happy, or we're fortunate to have with us Diane Douglas, who, as you most of you probably know, she was the superintendent of public instruction for 4 years, and she will be talking a little bit about what this bill does and why it's good or it's bad. And, you know, we value her opinion.
Thank you very much. Appreciate being here, both of you. I can't even get my head around why there is such a bill as this. I mean, I understand why the school districts want it, absolutely, to keep the funding rolling in. And maybe if the funding level were the same, but it was cut to the lower level of online learning.
She's a comedian too. You guys didn't know that, did you?
That might be a better thing for our taxpayers. But the reality is, quite frankly, this remote learning that they have put our children under this, I call it a pandemic that was created. We've had the year-long anniversary now. Schools were going to be closed, till just the end of March 2020? And how much they're back depends what school district you're looking at and what they're having. But we're seeing already what an absolute disaster it is. I mean, if you look at our state test results, you can see we are abysmal at teaching our children English, teaching them to read, teaching them to write, teaching them to do basic arithmetic when they're sitting in a classroom. And now we're expecting kindergartners and first graders to learn how to read with a monitor and no attention. This is what we've done to our children is beyond the pale, and quite frankly, I'm thankful I'm not sitting in the superintendent's office because I would have no part of this anymore. But I can't imagine what our legislators are thinking to say, okay, schools, now you have an option. You can keep the kids out as long as you want or let them do this alternative education, but we're going to give you the same funding for it regardless of what it is. There's no reason right now, right this minute, every student shouldn't be back, well, I would say in an education program. I don't think they should be back in schools that are failing to educate them.
Well, there's a few of those in Arizona also.
Unfortunately, the government monopoly.
Yeah.
So I don't know if there's anything else that I missed or Diana and I missed on this bill. Archie, did you spot any other?
Oh, I've got a couple of things. This bill will allow 100% of students to sit at home at the kitchen table and go to school. Now, if that's the case, you know, we don't need school buses anymore. We don't need school bus drivers anymore. We don't need the mechanics who prepare the school buses anymore. We don't need, you know, the cost of buying tires and brake fluid and all of that thing for them. We don't need crossing guards anymore. We don't need the people working in the cafeteria preparing food anymore. We don't need the custodians and the janitors anymore. We don't need the elaborate school facilities that we currently have anymore. So maybe what we should do then is start to reduce the amount of funding that we provide to the schools. And then maybe the schools will decide that it's time for the students to be in class and receive the benefits of the social interaction that they get from being with other students. And that's one of the main things that 2020 should have shown us, that a student being out of school is not a good thing.
This is anecdotal, and I admit that honestly, but the things that I'm hearing from our schools, even with some districts that have returned to in-person learning, there was one example that was brought to me where the students were in a high school, the students were all brought into class to attend their class and open up their laptops, and the teacher was at home teaching them. So one way or the other, they're still remote, and this is just not an effective way. We know we have enough problems in our schools, and I, no disrespect intended to teachers, you know, but our education system, I would say, is not effective, but actually, if you study American education, we are getting the exact results that it was created and intended to achieve. We have to do better by our children, and this is a huge mistake, in my opinion.
And that's why we highly recommend that you folks at home who are watching this, that you contact your legislators, in particular the members of the House Education Committee, and express your opposition to this bill. And you can do that easily by going to my website, which is acpeopleslobbyist.com. And you can email your legislators, you can call them on the phone. Actually, you can even use the RTS, the request to speak mm-hmm. system, because this bill is going to be heard in a committee, so they will accept comments regarding this bill at the RTS. So do everything you can if you agree with us, and hopefully you do, that this is not a good bill. And let it be known to those legislators so that they can vote this down. Keep in mind, regardless of what happened in the past, if the House Education Committee does not approve this bill, the bill will die. Okay, that's the way that it is set up in Arizona. So with that, please say no.
One other quick thought, may I add?
Go ahead.
I mean, and I understand the predicament that some parents are in and how challenging it may be for you. When you're concerned about your children's health and all. But there are other systems. There are online learning academies that have been in existence for 10, 20 years, whatever the case may be. I mean, our school districts do not have big, effective means of providing this type of education. And I think if the legislature is going to allow this to happen, parents have to realize their children are probably never going to be in an educational environment as they have come to know it. This is going to totally dismantle it. And where maybe that's a good thing, maybe it's not. I'll hold my thoughts on that to myself. But the reality is things will never be the same, and it will not be in the best interest of your children.
And one last thought on this, let's not forget the purpose why we're talking about this bill and what it does. And what we're looking at here is the funding. What the bill does is that it provides the same funding regardless of the level of education that they get.
If
it's better to have, and if they're proficient at long distance learning, teaching, that's one thing. But what we're doing here is we're funding that at the same level as the more expensive in-person learning. And that is what the bill does, and that's what I, for one, object vehemently to.
Well, and another thing, Jose, now that you know we're taking a closer look at it too, is for programs that are online and they're charter programs, or they are district programs that are much smaller scale, they go through an approval process. This is saying students can exercise this option and districts can offer it without being an approved Arizona online program. And that's very scary too.
Okay.
So vote no, please. House Bill HB 2017, short title, Appropriation STEM, S-T-E-M, Learning Workforce Development. Anytime we see appropriation in a bill, the red flag goes up, okay? This bill is going to be in the Senate Education Committee on the 23rd, and it was introduced by Representative Udall. And let me read to you briefly what the summary of this bill is from the legislature's website. Appropriates the sum of $3 million from the state general fund for the fiscal year 2022 of the Arizona to the Arizona Commerce Authority. Now that is a private organization that's going to get $3 million from our government. I call that monopoly money that they get to play with. I would love to have some of that $3 million to play monopoly with. But anyway, it's designed to administer a grant program to cultivate science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, which is what STEM stands for both learning and workforce development. Now, hear this. It is exempt from the provisions of ARS 35-190. Now, for those of you who do not know what ARS 35-190 is, that is the statute that says if you do not use the money that has been appropriated, you return it back to the general fund. But this bill is exempt from doing that, which means that the Arizona Commerce Authority gets to keep all their monopoly money to continue playing with it regardless of whatever happened. This is an extremely bad bill, okay? Yet, it passed the House 50-10. 50-10 it passed the House. Actually, two Democrats voted against it, which is surprising.
Very.
Yeah, two Democrats voting against it, and I'll out them just in case. Freeze and Powers Handley, both of them voted against the bill. And the other 10, the other 8 out of the 10 that voted against the bill were Republicans, and I'll tell you real quickly, because these are the only people that have any sense as far as I'm concerned regarding this bill. Burgess, Fillmore, Fincham, Grantham, Huffman, Parker, Payne, and Roberts. So thank you, you voted against this bill, but it wasn't enough. It passed 50-10. Now today, We are fortunate to have with us Diane Douglas to assist us with these education bills. Most of you already know that she is, or she was for 4 years, a full term, the superintendent of public instruction, which is the head office dealing with education in Arizona. So she is extremely well-versed in educational matters, and that's why we have her with us, assisting us with these education bills. We appreciate your help.
And it's a pleasure to be here, Jose and Archie. It's a pleasure to be here. One thing that Archie pointed out to me as we were looking, and I kind of went, $3 million, wow, is that is also, if I'm not mistaken, ongoing funding.
It is available for to, the wording says, that we anticipate that they're going to be doing this again next year. But the difference in it is that it doesn't say how much they're going to appropriate next year.
You mean it could be more?
Could be.
Yep, anything's possible.
STEM education is good for our children. Certainly, I keep telling every student, every child I run across, boy, learn to read, learn your mathematics, and you can write your own ticket this day and age with how poorly others are educated. But I think part of, you know, as they always say, the devil is in the details. And where exactly will this money be going? Well, first of all, it'll be under the purview of Arizona Commerce Authority, which is a private organization, correct?
Correct.
So they're getting taxpayer money. It could go to, if you don't mind me just reading a little bit, entities in a county that have established a network of cross-institutional partners from business, education, community, and government. It can go to schools and school districts, which are already being funded to teach kids science and math and technology and engineering studies. Out of school programs, I don't even know what that means. Museum science centers with expertise in STEM, higher education institutes, and other entities that recognize a need for STEM competencies. Is there going to be any way to evaluate how the Commerce Authority uses this money? Will it be, borrowing from my husband, what if technology is COBOL that nobody wants anymore, nobody needs anymore, nobody sees? What is the evaluation going to be of how effective these programs are? And quite frankly, I always get very nervous about funding programs like this. Where did this come from? Who gave Representative Udall the bug in her ear that this was a needed program, additional funding over and above? And I get wary that, sometimes very precious taxpayer dollars are going to end up in pockets of people who have an idea that may or may not be effective, that have just a program they've pushed along through to the legislators, and or is it Brother Joe or Cousin Harry's?
The way I look at this is that we have in place in the schools, I think we, if they don't, they should, have in place in school this type of education where you do teach the kids the math and the science and all that.
And we also have what are called CTEDs, Career Technical Education Districts, that tend to be more learning and certification for industry to get kids through, but they can still touch in many of these areas, and they have their own funding source. I get very wary of public money to private industries and private organizations and what exactly is going to happen with it. And not just from the cynical taxpayer point of view, but dollars are very precious. And we need to get what we can to our children. We can't just give gifts, if you will, blank checks that will be spent. I think before anybody thinks about voting yes for this, there needs to be a lot more answers on what's the $3 million going to be spent on? What is the oversight going to be for the $3 million? Once they get it, can they basically do whatever their board chooses to do with it? And exactly how much are we thinking it's going to be down the line? And I very much disagree with funding for arbitrary programs like this that if they don't use the money, it doesn't get reverted back to the general fund. That's another big problem, in my opinion.
Yeah, well, I can tell you what I always say when I read one of these bills and it's introduced by Udall. Grab your wallet. Mm-hmm. Udall don't know what she's doing.
That's where I disagree. She knows exactly what she's doing.
Well, I suppose from that point, she yes. probably does, and she's under the thumb of the teachers' unions.
Well, yeah. I don't even see
but
this as
understand,
a teachers' unit. What lobbyist brought this? That would be my question.
Well,
that's where I think it comes from, whoever represents the Arizona Commerce Authority.
Well, the Arizona Commerce Authority was created, I can't remember now how many years ago, but when they were created, it was created by statute. It is a public-private partnership. And they were provided with their own source of funding when it was created. Now, this is an appropriation over and above what they already get. And as I pointed out to you, you know, they're anticipating that they're going to appropriate monies each and every year hereafter. That's what's provided for in the bill. I have no problem with STEM, and I have no problem with STEM in remote areas of the state of Arizona. But I do have a major problem with appropriating money to a private organization and allowing them to just spend it however they want to. And there's no requirements here on any requirement for them to provide any oversight on how they spend this money. And also, the money is not, it's an anti-lapse. The money does not lapse and go back to the general fund. You gotta watch your wallet whenever you're talking about appropriations and Udall. Now, the other thing I'll point out to you that with the special appropriations bill this year, we are approaching $1 billion in appropriations out of the budget over and above the regular budget. These are just coming out of the general funds.
And that, folks, don't forget that our budget, what, was 11-something billion last time?
Yeah, it's going to be over 12.
About 12. So we're already talking about at least 8% over and above whatever the budget turns out to be with these special appropriations.
Yes.
In an economy that's been shut down for a year.
Yeah. Right now, our unemployment rate is 6.7 in Arizona, partially because of what we have done regarding the virus and so on and so forth. So we really cannot afford to do these things and remain solvent.
We can't, and as we talked about a bill last week in which there was an appropriation, a special appropriation of $300 million. That's a lot of money. That's
yeah,
a lot
well,
of money.
A million here and a million there, pretty soon you're talking mm-hmm. real money, huh?
And another thought on what you mentioned, Archie, that the Arizona Commerce Authority already has its own funding source.
It does.
So my thought would be, I mean, if I were in business and I spent many years in business, you know, your money is your money, your funding is your funding. So if you think STEM and this program is so important, I don't know what else they do. I'm not impugning the work they do, but it becomes a give and take. So if mm-hmm. this is that important, look at your budget, find out what programs may not be as effective now as they used to be or may not be as needed now, and then fund this program.
Mm-hmm.
That's
I agree.
Responsible.
I agree.
But why do that? Why do that when you can go to the taxpayer and get more money?
Yeah.
With that, folks, our consensus is contact your legislators, the members of the Senate Education Committee, and say no, no, no. House Bill HB 2307, short title, Voting Equipment Over Vote Notice. This bill is going to be in the Senate Government Committee on the 22nd. Is that Monday? I believe that's Monday. Is it Monday or Tuesday? Anyway, it's going to be on the heard in the Senate Government Committee on Tuesday.
Tuesday.
And it was introduced by Representative Kavanaugh. Now, this bill, we talked about it when it was originally in the House, so we're not going to have a whole lot to say about it in order to find out what we have discuss regarding this bill, all you have to do is go to YouTube and go to my channel. And to access my channel, all you have to do is go onto the, on the search box and type in my name, Jose Borajero. And then when you get to my channel, do a search. And you can search for whatever bill you're interested in. In this case, it'll be HB 2307. So we're not going to spend a whole lot of time. What did happen since the last time we talked is that it did clear the House 52-0. Now, that means to us that there's not a whole lot that we can discuss about this bill because it is extremely popular. Nobody's willing to go against it. Fortunately, we do like this bill. We have issued a yes suggestion for this bill. And we don't know why 8 individuals decided not to vote at all. But again, that's not necessarily because they don't like the bill. They may have had other reasons, whatever. So with that, Archie, if you have something else to add since the last time we talked, we can do that. I really don't have anything more to add.
No, I think it's a good bill.
Yeah, make sure you contact your legislators either by going to my website, which is acpeopleslobbyist.com, and do your emailing from there, or go to the request to speak system and vote yes in support of House Bill 2307. House Bill HB 2308. Short title, Recall Petitions and Elections, Revisions. This bill is one that is a little controversial. It was introduced by Representative Kavanaugh, and it cleared the House, but barely, and it will be heard in the Senate Government Committee on Tuesday, the 22nd. The vote in the House was 31-28. It was along party lines, and 28 Democrats voted against it, and one decided not to vote for whatever reason. So it is one of those bills that, like so many of them, they go according to party line. Now, what it does, what this bill does, is that it modifies the requirements for recall petitions and elections, and it increases the requirements for paid or out-of-state circulators. I don't know how many of you in the audience know that we have different rules when you're circulating a petition. We have different rules if it is a volunteer in-state organization is one thing, but if it's a volunteer organization from out of state and or a paid gatherer of signatures, then there's a different set of rules. And what this bill does is that it increases those requirements. So it is, for all intents and purposes, the way I see it, pretty much a housekeeping bill. But you may have something else on it, Archie. And do you see any red flags in here or any?
Well, I have a couple of things on it. This bill is mostly, as I said, it's about the circulators of the petition, the ones going out and getting the signatures and the things that they need. That's what this bill is mostly about. There are some provisions that are kind of vague and uncertain. And there are two provisions where a person who is signed may withdraw their signature from a petition. And the requirements for that are set up, one on page 1 and the other one on page 9 of the bill. But if you look at those two requirements on where a person who signed a petition for a recall petition or basically any other petition, where circulators got your signatures, the requirements for the two are different. So maybe Mr. Kavanaugh might want to take a look at that and make sure those provisions are the same. Then the other thing I have a question about is that these petitions have to be, you know, they're voted on by, have to be voted on by an electorate, somebody that's a qualified voter. So you can, only qualified voters can vote on it, but anyone, and the provision says that, it says that anybody can challenge the underlying document that is being circulated for it to be presented to the voters. Now, if anyone can challenge it, it would seem like anyone should be able to vote on it or sign it. But, I mean, it seems just kind of inconsistent to me. Otherwise, I think it's probably a good thing.
Okay, and we're still in agreement that when you contact your legislators, you should request a yes vote on it. House Bill HB 2570, short title, Licenses, Pandemics, Revocation, Prohibition. This bill was introduced by Representative Hoffman, and it cleared the House. It will be heard in the Senate Government Committee on Tuesday, and it barely cleared the House with a vote of 31 to 29. And folks, we're seeing a lot of this. It's common that people are voting in the legislature. They're voting according to party line, and this is no exception. All Republicans voted yes, and all Democrats voted no. Considering what this bill does, it is very, I don't understand why the Democrats wanted to vote no on it. I would think that they would be in favor of it, but then again,
you
I'm
think
not.
So, yes.
Yeah, I don't know how a Democrat thinks, but it doesn't make sense. Basically, here's the summary, as taken from the legislature's website. Does not allow. In other words, it prohibits the department, any other state agency or a city, town, or county to revoke any license that is required to operate a business for not complying with an order issued by the governor pursuant to this section unless the department, other state agency, etc., can demonstrate by clear and convincing evidence that the business was the actual cause of transmission of the disease that is subject of the order. Now, that's a mouthful, even for me. Now, basically what it means is that if you cannot just go ahead and revoke a license if somebody doesn't comply with the order.
Well, I don't know if you recall, but I don't know, some months ago, like last July or so, there was at least one business, and I believe it was somebody who ran a gymnasium.
Right, yes.
A gym, and said, you know, not a gymnasium, but a gym. And he said, I don't care what you say, I'm going to open up.
Yeah.
And I don't know, I think it was the governor, basically, that said, if you do, we're going to pull your license and you can't operate your business at all, forever. And that's what this bill is designed to circumvent. And I think from that standpoint, it's a really good idea.
Yeah, it's a good idea. We should not put somebody out of business simply because, and the bill takes into account that if the business has been negligent, you can.
Right.
Okay.
Yes.
I mean, if there is a clear and convincing evidence that the business engaged in something that they shouldn't have engaged in, you revoke the license. That's fine.
Right.
But you cannot do it just because you don't like the fact that they were not in compliance with the order, which may not have been a valid order to begin with. So this is another one of these bills that is designed to establish a balance between what the governor can do in a pandemic and what he cannot do. And as such, you would think that all Democrats would be voting in favor of it.
Mm-hmm.
But they don't. I think they're just being Democrats. That's the only thing I can say.
Well, there is one thing I think that Mr. Hoffman might want to consider about making an amendment to his bill, and that is if you read this code section, the code section has no provision for when an emergency declared by the governor terminates. There's no provision for it in this bill or anywhere else in the code. where the powers of the government to declare an emergency has a termination date.
There are bills, at least one bill, and I don't know if we're going to be talking about it today. We may even be talking about today. But there's one bill over there that establishes that within so many days, I believe it's 30 days, if the legislature does not renew it, that the order from the government does expire.
I believe that bill was not passed. And my recollection is that again, Mr. Boyer joined with the other side and voted against that bill, and my recollection is that bill did not pass out of the House.
Oh, okay, that could be the case.
And that's why I bring this up, about maybe he wants to change it so that there is some limitation on how long the emergency declaration by the governor can last. But otherwise, it lasts until the governor says it's over.
Yeah, well, but what the bill actually addresses is the license itself.
No,
so
I understand.
At least, and this would be a good time to make an observation as to amendments. Yeah, you can amend the bill at any time, but if the bill passed the first chamber, in this case it would have been the House of Representatives, and then it is amended in the Senate,
it has to go back to the House.
Yeah, it has to go back to the House. So unless the amendment is really compelling, I would think that most supporters of a bill would be reluctant to amend the bill and run the risk of going back to the original chamber and not passing there. So these amendments at this stage of the game are going to be rare. But regardless, we like the bill. It's a good bill in spite of its limitations. And we really recommend that if you're going to contact your legislators, and we hope that you do, that you would request a yes vote on this bill. House Bill HB 2715, short title, Residential Picketing Offense. This bill was introduced by Representative Kavanaugh. It will be heard in the House Senate Government Committee. No, excuse me, it's going to be heard in the Senate Government Committee on Tuesday. And this bill is designed, I believe that the motivation behind this bill is the fact that so many legislators and public officials are having to deal with picketing at their residence, at their homes. And that's really not a good thing. I mean, okay, so you want to picket the office, you want to picket the government agency. That's one thing, but to go into a residential neighborhood and start picketing, not a good thing. And what this bill does, it aims at discouraging that sort of behavior from the summary of the bill. It says that it modifies the offense of residential picketing to include a person who intentionally engages in picketing around the residence of an individual with the intent to harass, annoy, or alarm the individual. And what it does is that it creates or increases the penalty so that it is now a Class 3 misdemeanor as a result of this bill if passed. It did have support from those sides of the aisle, which is rare, but they did it did get that support. It passed in the House 35 to 24. And actually, of those 24, we have that four of the representatives from the Democrat side voted for it. So we did get some Democrat, at least four Democrats have enough common sense to say, hey, we cannot have people picketing people's houses. So to that extent, I am glad that they did, and I welcome their yes vote. The rest of the votes for yes were from the Republicans. I don't have anything else to add other than say, you know, this is a good bill. We should get it passed. Archie, did you find any flaws in the bill that should be corrected or be brought to attention?
I think the bill is a result of, I don't know if you recall or not, I don't know if it was Antifa or if it was Black Lives Matter, but at some point back last year, they indicated and they said, we're coming to your neighborhood. And I think this is a participatory bill, and I think that's probably a good idea. But I do think that one of the things that's going to be going to create a probably lawsuits, because I mean, who determines intent? And if you come out to picket my house and I'm not there, are you really causing me any problems? And probably not. Not under the state of the bill, but otherwise, I think that the bill is good. And
yeah.
No reason not to.
Yeah. This is a definite yes. House Bill HB 2770. We have talked about this bill quite a bit, so we're not going to be talking a whole lot. This bill 2770 is the one that has to do with the the short title is Mask Mandates Business Exemption. And it has been making its way through the legislature. It cleared the House 31-28, which is pretty much along party lines. Only one individual from the Democrats neglected or decided not to vote, but the rest, the 28, decided to vote against it, and 31 Republicans voted for it. And what it does is that, let me read the summary of this. Notwithstanding any other law, a business in this state is not required to enforce on its premises a mask mandate that is established by the state, a city, town, or county, or any other jurisdiction of this state. Basically, what that means is that if you issue an edict that says you cannot wear that you have to wear a mask, you cannot make the business enforce that mandate. Now, the Republicans voted for it, the Democrats voted against it. If this were to pass, and it looks like it's headed that way, what would the governor do about this? Because there's every indication that he may want to veto this bill.
And I don't know why.
You don't know why?
No.
Well, because he gives an order and he's going to enforce it. And now we're saying that no, you cannot enforce that law or that edict. And so he could be very well be inclined to veto it. The only reason for not doing it is that it might create a lot of antipathy towards the governor. But we already have enough of that.
But remember, the governor has not issued a mandatory mandate. And what he has said is, I'm going to leave that up to the cities and counties and the mayors and whatever, and the board of supervisors. They can make their own. And many towns have issued mandatory mandates. I think the city of Phoenix is one of them.
The intent was clear, and I know what you're saying, and I agree with you, that the governor, technically speaking, the governor has not issued a mandate that says you must do this. He did, in fact, say to the cities, well, you can do this, and, of course, the cities have, most of them, have complied with his wishes, if not their edict. But most people consider that, for all intents and purposes, the governor did issue an order, even though in the reality he did not. But regardless, this would, if he were to issue an order after this law were to pass, then he would not be able to do that. So we don't know what he intends to do. It looks like it's going to pass the House as well as the Senate, or the Senate as well as the House, and be sent to the governor. We'll see what happens. In the meantime, my recommendation is that you folks contact your members of the Senate Government Committee and express your wish that they vote yes on this bill. House Bill HCR 2001. Short title, Initiative, Single Issue, a single subject title. This bill is going to be heard in the Senate Government Committee on Tuesday, It was introduced by Representative Kavanaugh, and it's what I refer to as a truth in advertising bill. What it does very simply is that it requires that the title of when you have an initiative that, or a referendum for that matter, that is put to the public for a vote, that it includes in the title every subject that the initiative covers. And the reason for that is that, unfortunately, we have had situations in which they say, okay, this initiative is going to do A and B, but then deep in the bowels of the initiative, there is a C, a third provision that people were not aware of, and they vote for it based on the two that were disclosed and the third one was not disclosed, and then you have a problem. And what this does is that it mandates that if you're going to have a provision, that it has to be clearly disclosed in the title of the bill, or in the title of the initiative, or the proposition. Mm-hmm. And to me, that makes a whole lot of sense. Now, the vote, when it went through the House, the vote there, the full House voted 31 to 28 with one abstention. And again, it was party line. All 31 Republicans voted for it. 28 Democrats voted against it, and one Democrat did not vote, even though he was present. Why Democrats are against full disclosure of what's in an initiative is beyond me, but they are, as evidenced by their vote. My recommendation is, this is definitely a yes vote. So when you contact your members of the Senate Government Committee, I would like for you to express your opinion in favor of this particular bill. Unless Archie has a contrary.
Well, I've got the same problem I've always had. Anytime you have a bill that makes a provision for amending of a constitution, the Arizona Constitution, you need to look at it really, really, really close. Now, this bill in and of itself does not amend the Constitution, but it does go, well, wait a minute, I don't know. Maybe
no, I think it's a statute. I don't think it's a Constitution amendment.
No, it says it's going to amend the Constitution.
It is a Constitution amendment?
Yeah, proposing an amendment to the Constitution.
Yeah.
So it is an amendment, a Constitution amendment. You need to pay a close attention to that. The other thing that I got two things that I would note. One is, why doesn't this rule also apply to referendums? Right? It only applies to initiatives. And initiatives are one that's brought by the public, and a referendum is brought by the legislature. Why would the same rule apply to a referendum as it does to the initiative? Then I would suggest that Mr. Kavanaugh might want to go back and take a look at this and make a provision for an amendment. Understand that an initiative or a referendum as it currently exists can be passed by a 50% of the votes cast plus one vote. And you're going to allow, and when you stop to think about it, on a primary election in 2020, the primary election, only 36% of the registered voters turned up to vote. Okay. And now this only requires 50% of that. So you're going to allow, basically 500,000 people to be able to amend the Constitution when you've got over 7 million people in the state of Arizona. That figure is way, way too low. Way too low. It needs to be adjusted. So, I think he needs to go back and make an amendment to this and require and up the number of people that need to vote.
Yeah, if you're going to have in this case, it will be a referendum because it will be brought up by the legislature. If you're going to go through the trouble and expense of having this included in the election, then it makes a whole lot of sense to make it so that in order to amend the Constitution, you need at least two-thirds vote. I am not very happy at all with the idea that, what I call a mob, really, a mob of 50% plus one of that particular mob can amend the constitution of a state. And again, if it's done by the voters, then it's virtually impossible to reverse, because it's very difficult to muster enough support to reverse a constitutional amendment that was put in there by the voters. So for all intents and purposes, this is permanent. And so far, we have no way of indicating to the public that this is permanent. There is a bill floating around that would do that, but it's questionable as to whether that bill is going to pass or not. But as of now, there's no indication when somebody goes to the voting booth or when they fill out their mail-in ballot that that this is going to be, for all intents and purposes, a permanent a change that, that will not be cannot be reversed. But still, the underlying figure here, the underlying theme, is that of a single subject. So as long as we do not have anything to change elsewhere, at least we can change this one possibly. That we have full disclosure when we have an initiative. Not the best, but better than nothing. And for that reason, I'm still suggesting a yes vote on it. House Bill HCR 2016. Short title, Initiative Supermajority Vote Requirement. This bill cleared the House, and it is going to be heard in the Senate Government Committee on Tuesday. The way it cleared the House was exactly 31 to 29, right along party lines. It was introduced by Representative Dunn. And what it does, initially, when this bill was introduced, it would have increased the vote required to pass an initiative from a simple majority to a supermajority of 60%. But it has since been amended to, instead of requiring a supermajority of 60, it's only 55%. To me, that's a bad move. Which should be at least 60, possibly 66, or two-thirds. And as I understood it initially, it would apply only to initiatives that would increase taxes, but apparently it applies to all initiatives. But regardless of the change, I'm in agreement that still it should be a yes vote on this. Again, Republicans are in favor of it. Democrats are against it. I'm sure that there has to be some initiative that go in there that the Democrats would not want, and they would want to limit it somehow. They would want to have a supermajority regardless of what the subject is. So I don't know why the Democrats keep on voting against something like this.
Maybe one day we can have a guest Democrat on here to tell us.
Perhaps we can have a, because I don't understand all of these bills that benefit the Democrats as much as benefit the Republicans. They keep on voting no on it.
And I'm going to tell you the same thing I told you on the prior bill, and that is, this is an amendment to the Constitution. Read it carefully. I agree that, you know, under the prior provisions, it only required 50% plus one vote. This one at least requires 55%, and I suspect that Mr. Dunn, in order to get this passed, had to reduce it off of the 60% down to the 55 so that he could get all of the Republicans voting for it. And in my humble opinion, 60% is an absolute minimum, and you should have more when you're going to amend the Constitution. If it is just a law that is proposed by the public, then that's great, you know, 55%, 60%, I suppose, because it can then be overturned in any number of ways. But in this case, when you're talking about an amendment to the Constitution, it becomes very, very, very dangerous. And understand, this also applies not only to initiatives, but it applies to referendums.
Okay, this one applies to both?
It applies to both.
Okay, well, that's a good thing. Again, we're dealing with, and this is good, a good time to bring this up. We haven't brought it up lately, but it's something that we need to remind voters all the time, and that is that we are in a situation where we have a 31 to 29 split in the House of Representatives, and we have a 16 to 14 split in the Senate. What that means is that it's so close that every bill that comes through has to please everyone. And when you have something that has to please everyone, you're not going to get what you really should have. You get what you can. And that's this is a typical example. Not only did we not get in the bill the 66% that would have been much better, it initially was only 60, and even that has to be reduced to 55 to satisfy those people who would have otherwise opposed the bill. So we are in a bad situation between a rock and a hard place. Mm-hmm. So that's why normally I would say this bill is worthless because it doesn't give us enough of what we want and it should be voted down. But I'm not saying that. I'm saying, yes, we should pass this bill. And the voters should approve it once it goes to the voters, because even though it's not what we want, at least it gets us a tiny little bit closer to what we would want.
That's
so
true.
With that, I humbly request that people who contact legislators contact the Senate Government Committee members and request a yes vote on this bill. And this brings to a close this week's edition of Arizona Bill Watch. Thank you very much for watching. If you like what you saw, tell your friends. Make sure you tune in next week for more in-depth discussion of important and controversial bills with me, Jose Borajero, and Archie Dixon. In the meantime, remember, stay conservative, my friends.